Mustafa.
Bye-bye.
Watermelon? Yes.
Tonight, what's wrong with our schools?
I don't like to blame it on teachers, but I would say the teachers.
And when it rains, we run for the buckets because the roof leaks.
So you're saying it's the structure of the system that's the problem?
The system is actually, it's actually advantaging some
families. Determined by themselves.
Not a great picture, Peter Garrish, is it, really?
What needs to be done to give every Australian child a fair go in the classroom?
It was a massive change, and it wasn't an easy thing to do.
So how many of the staff that you had did you keep?
We changed roughly 45% of the staff.
Wow. If you had his job...
Careful what you wish for.
if you had his job, what would you do?
$5 billion.
Hi, I'm Jenny Brockie. How big is the gap between schools around the country and what does it mean for our kids? Welcome, everybody. Good to have you all here. Jacob, let me start with you. You're 17. Tell me what your reading levels were when you dropped out of a state school, the state high school you were at last year.
They weren't very high at all, actually. They were quite poor compared
to
everyone. I was probably in 10th grade when I dropped out, probably a 7th grader or lower.
Your reading was at the level of a 7th grader?
Yeah, or lower.
And why so low? Why do you think that was the case?
I just had a rough time going through school, like reading, learning. It's just hard for me to learn.
Mm-hmm. And what was the school like? How did the school deal with that?
The school helped me do the work, like they helped me read and write, but they didn't actually help me like to learn for myself, to do it myself. They didn't really help me with it.
So you were really depending on having a teacher with you all the time to be able to do it?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll get on to what happened after that in a moment. But before we do, Emily, I know you've been talking to Jacob before we started tonight. How different is your experience of school to that?
Very, very different. I think it's less to do with the school itself and more to do with just our backgrounds. I mean, I naturally took, you know, an aptitude to learning, and I never found school difficult, and I love school, and I think
you're 11,
yes,
and you're at an academically selective high school in Sydney,
yes.
Government school,
yes.
What sort of attention do you get at your school?
A lot. Our teachers are very committed, and I mean, I think it's partly because we're quite easy to teach. But, I mean, they are, like, very, very dedicated, and we're very thankful for that.
OK, so before you went to that school, that's academically selective school, you went to a country school on the coast.
Yes.
How did they compare?
The teaching standard probably wasn't as high, and also the student standard wasn't as high.
But you think there was a difference between the teaching at that school and the school you're at now?
Definitely, but I mean, I think it would be better to compare my other primary school to that. And in that case, I mean, it was hard because there were only two teachers. So with my other primary school, if you got a bad teacher for 1 year, you'd be guaranteed to get a different teacher the next year, and chances are they'd be better. Whereas in the country school, there were only two teachers, so there wasn't really much choice.
Mm. Martina, what about you? I mean, I just wonder, listening to those two, where did your old school fit in this?
Good question. My old school was pretty much between them both, because we had the points where there was, of course, the low points, and it got to the point where a lot of the students were down about it. As Jacob said, he had a rough time, and there was a lot of students that did have a rough time, but then we also had a lot of students that were needing the challenge and they weren't getting it.
Why do you think they weren't getting it? What was happening at the school?
There was too much going on. There was a whole round laziness throughout the whole school, and it became like a virus. The moment one person got lazy, everyone got lazy.
Where do you think it came from originally, that laziness?
I don't like to blame it on teachers, but I would say the teachers.
Why?
Because I believe that you need the teachers to be able to push you. The teachers want to be there to teach you and to push you to do what you want to do, right? And say, if the teacher doesn't motivate you in math, you're not going to want to do math. You're going to hate the subject.
What were you doing during all this yourself, like with all this laziness going on around you? What were you doing?
Don't want to use the word bludging, but I will. I took a lazy streak. I was just following along with everyone else because it seemed like the easiest thing to do.
And do you think it would have been different if you'd been at, say, another school?
Yeah. It would have been
way different. Did you have friends at other schools and did you compare what it was like?
I met people from private schools and they were saying how much homework they got and how much they were studying in class. And I was sitting there going, where was my homework? Like, why weren't the teachers pushing us to do that sort of thing?
What about you Jacob? Were you hearing stories from friends of yours at other schools about it being different?
I had some friends from my old area where I used to live. They just had, like, pretty much worse than me. They had, like, pretty much no homework. There was this, like, shit with her school. There was a lot of laziness and stuff. And just, yeah.
Not a great picture, Peter Garrish, is it, really?
Look, I'm not sure that we can generalise about Australia's schooling system on the basis of the experiences that we've had here, although I know they're really real for our guests.
Well, they're mixed, you know.
Yeah, that's right. But, I mean, the fact is that teacher effectiveness or teacher quality is a key inside any school. If you've got a teacher that's teaching you well, then you're going to be interested and you're going to do well. And I think that on the whole, our teachers in schools, both government and non-government schools, do a great job.
But we also know there's a gap. We know that there's a big gap between students' performance. We've had that shown in the Gonski report, the recent report that the government commissioned into schools. For a rich country like Australia, why is it that we have such a big gap, do you think?
I think one of the reasons is that we've got what Mr. Gonski and his panel identified, which was called compounding disadvantage. So if you have a student who's from a low socioeconomic background, who perhaps doesn't have high levels of English language proficiency, perhaps in a remote area as well, then they are clearly not going to be able to successfully travel through their schooling journey as much as, say, a kid from a better off background would do.
Should they be able to?
Yes, of course they should. I mean, it's absolutely essential for us as a country to make sure that every student, no matter where they're living and no matter how much money their parents are earning, gets the best possible education. It's partly why we commissioned Mr. Gonski to do that work, because we do want to have a system which will deliver that.
OK, we'll get on to the detail of what might happen or not out of that a bit later on. Marius, I just wonder what you think hearing about remote communities and education. You're the chairman of an independent secondary college in the Tiwi Islands. Do the kids in the Tiwi Islands get an equal chance at an education, do you think, to other kids in the country?
Well, it's true what Minister Garrett is saying, and I think a lot is being done with good intentions. Unfortunately, those good intentions aren't really met.
Why aren't they working, do you think? What sort of problems are you having in the Tiwi Islands?
Well, it's I think the best intention is to bring good quality teachers, and we do get quality teachers to come there. But obviously, being away from their big cities, and the other things that come with living in a remote community is a big problem for a lot of these teachers that come.
So you can't keep them?
We can keep them as long as they want, but there are other things that come into play in trying to retain these quality teachers.
How many kids go through to high school?
Not many, unfortunately. I'm talking about the top end. And those that do sometimes find it hard because there is no career jobs, pathways that leads to these jobs in our communities.
Mm. Morganix, you do hip-hop workshops in schools around the country. Now, you visit a lot of remote communities. How different are the schools that you visit doing those hip-hop workshops one to another?
I mean, to be honest, in a lot of the remote schools I've worked in or regional schools I've been in, sometimes I can walk into somewhere, you know, that's, 2 hours drive from the next town or next community, and there might be like 8 Mac computers sitting up the back gathering dust and, you know, a whole lot of amazing software that's all set up there, which I drool over as a producer and, musician myself. And but the problem often can be that the staff...
don't know how to use it?
Yeah, they might have the hardware, but they may not have the training and the software to be able to use all that stuff.
And the lady behind you here is nodding her head. Why are you agreeing so strongly with that?
I just... I'm a teacher and I'm technologically inept. So I understand this. And I know that there is certainly opportunities for teachers to be trained, but definitely not nearly enough.
Naomi, you teach at a government primary school in the western suburbs of Sydney. Let's have a look at what it's like in your classroom.
We're at Hampton Park Primary School, which is a very large school in La Kemba. We've got 700 students. I teach a kindergarten class and get 20 children in my class. It's got quite a varied cultural makeup. I think there's 98.5% non-English speaking background. The majority of students start with very little English language skills and very little understanding of how our language works, how we read a book.
Listen carefully to my retell. In the story, The Very Hungry Caterpillar, there was a caterpillar.
Yes.
Have I finished?
No.
The majority of them are unable to identify initial sounds in words. Majority of them can't write their own name yet, and they're generally speaking in single word utterances. So that's the starting point.
What kind of fruits did he eat?
Strawberries.
Strawberries. Asmina.
Chocolate cake.
Chocolate cake. Mustafa.
Strawberry.
Watermelon. Yes.
I tend to have my lessons as very targeted, very explicit, very focused lessons. I use a lot of visuals because they can see it. So even if they're not understanding exactly what I'm saying in English, the visuals are there to support that learning.
Plums in the right place, please.
Although the students are coming from that low SES background, the only thing that we really need to be mindful of is that these students can achieve.
High five. Thank you for helping me. Beautiful.
You look very proud of those kids.
I am so proud of those children. They have come so far in the 8-9 weeks that we've been at school.
So most of them, when they came to you, couldn't speak English at all?
Very little English. And so there is a lot of effort that goes into providing them with the opportunity to increase their oral language acquisition so that they are able to function in a class setting, in a school setting, in the local environment.
And did you have specific training to do this when you trained as a teacher?
No, I did a regular primary education degree. I have been really fortunate in that the school I'm at puts a great emphasis on teacher quality. And we have had a lot of opportunities for professional development.
I'm trying to paint a picture of this gap, like in all its complexity, because there's a lot to look at. I want to come back to you just quickly, Morganics, though, about your work doing the hip-hop workshops. How big are the contrasts?
Well, I mean, I work in a lot of different schools, and I do remember one day I turned up to a very wealthy private school. I walked into the room and someone said to me, check out the new timpanis. And I was like, wow, the shiny timpani drums, you know, these look amazing. And they just had, you know, a very expensive refurbishments go on. And I knew that just, you know, a couple of kilometres down the road, there was a primary school that where classes were being held in sort of prefab buildings that were dripping. And so for me, I just sort of felt like it's quite criminal to sort of see in that context that, you know, this school is probably getting as much funding, if not more funding, than that public school down the road, which is very difficult for the teachers to run a basic class in.
Naomi, you're nodding your head. You agree with that?
Well, it's true. I mean, if you think about having a strong P&C, there's a lot of schools who receive additional funding for teachers, for resourcing, for excursions through a strong PNC.
And a strong PNC with resources is going to be in a wealthy area.
Of course, of course, with a parent body that's able to contribute time and money.
Jane.
There's something else I think that makes a big difference between schools. And yes, of course it's resourcing and yes, it's all of those kinds of things, but it's also cultural capital. It's the kind of confidence that middle class parents and pass on to their children about how you're going to be able to just negotiate academia, about schools, about those kinds of things. My daughter is a teacher in a Western Suburbs high school and she went to a co-ed comprehensive public school on the North Shore of Sydney. She just went back to talk to her old drama teacher to get some tips on how to work with her students. And she said, I'd forgotten, Mum, how privileged my old public school was in comparison to the one that I'm working in now in Emu Plains. And just the aspirations that the teachers have for their students are completely different from the two different areas. And that's all about cultural capital. It's not just about resources.
But what can you do about that? And, I mean, Kevin, I know that you advocate choice and more competition between schools. How much do you think we can bridge this gap?
Well, firstly, if I could, I disagree that wanting your child to do well is simply a middle-class attribute. I grew up in a working-class area in Broadmeadows in Melbourne, and working-class people can have aspirations for their children. So I think we need to be careful that we don't talk about disadvantage as being something that determines.
But I don't think that's what Jane was saying. I think what Jane was saying was cultural capital, was the idea of valuing education, that for a start that gives you an advantage as
a kid. It does, and I was driving in today in the taxi, a guy from Bangladesh, he'd been here for 4 years, married, two children, and he probably did it hard in Bangladesh, but he was very thankful to be in Australia, like many migrants are, and his view is that he will give his kids a good education.
But
and
can I ask parent, you the, I want to ask you the question about choice,
if you have
though.
Books in the home, if you have books, if you talk to your children over dinner, if you turn off the Game Boy and the laptop and the computer and actually interact with your children, take them to museums, take them to galleries, take them to theatre, give them books to read.
That all costs money, children, Kevin. That all costs money.
I think e-books are pretty cheap these days.
Is it that easy, Blake?
It's not that easy. And what about the parents that... There's children, sorry, whose parents really aren't as committed to their child's future. It's them that fall through the cracks, and it's them that currently the system allows to fall through the cracks.
What do you think, Jacob, listening to this?
I think what he said, had like to read them books and go to the movies, and like she said, they're normally in their native language, which not is English, so it's getting hard to teach them English and like to get them started off at school.
Now, you grew up in a bilingual household, like Polish and...
English.
English. Yes. Was that difficult for you in terms of education?
Very.
Why?
Because my mum normally spoke English, but then she would say a few words in Polish and then change back to English. So my vowels and that all got mixed up because it's different languages.
OK. Do you think you've all got an equal opportunity for an even education? You know, for a similar education?
No way.
No, Martina?
No,
why?
I'm saying no. Like, there's... It's just so different. I reckon if I was to go to Emily's school, I wouldn't cope because it would be throwing me into the deep end. I was never prepared from a young age. Jacob being thrown into a school like Emily's, I'm thinking he wouldn't have been prepared, as he said from what he said before, sorry. There's such a difference that it's ridiculous.
Do you think you could have done better at a different school?
Maybe, yes, if I did go to Emily's school and I had started with a better education when I was younger and just carried.
Tonight we're talking about how to give our kids an equal chance of a good education. Emily, I just wonder how you feel about having all the smartest kids concentrated in your selective government high school. What's the benefit for you of being in a selective high school?
We're all like-minded people. I mean, everybody in my school has a genuine interest for learning. And, like, in any other school, in any other environment that I'm in, like, I do dancing. So when I go to dancing, me and my friends who also go to Sydney Girls are, you know, sort of labelled as the nerds. Like, we use big words and we're, you know, on a different level of conversation to them. Like, not a better level or in any way, just a different level. Like, I can't connect with them in the same way that I can with my classmates.
Shiming, you go to the academically selective government school next door to Emily's. What do you think, the boys' school?
It's all about the cohort and, like, your students. And with a selective school, your students really, like, the people around you in your year really push you to be your best and achieve your best academically.
And you guys all, just for the benefit of people in other states, you've all got to sit a test at the end of year six, yeah?
Yep.
To get into these schools, and you've got to get right up there to get in.
Yeah, it's all about the students that you're with, and they create the academic atmosphere that you're in, and their academic pursuit, and because they want to do that, you want to do that, and then you want to beat them, and then with 180 students, it's just beat, and it's just this big chain of competition.
And what about the other kids left behind in the other schools? How do they go, do you think?
I think the other government schools, like, if they, like, there's an opportunity for them to go into selective schools, like, everyone has an equal opportunity to sit the test, and it's all about your individual effort into whether you want to do that, whether that's...
Okay, head's shaking over here. Disagreement in the back row, yes. Yeah, you're Emily's mum.
I'm Emily's mother, and I shocked Emily in the car on the way because I said if I had a choice, I would abolish selective schools. She's horrified by this. She loves her school and she really enjoys it, and it's a wonderful school, and the teachers are really good. But they are no better than the teachers in other government schools. I have three children. I have three daughters. I have one who goes to a selective school. I have one who got into a selective school but didn't want to go and went to a private school on a scholarship, and I cannot begin to describe how much we disliked it. The younger two go to the local comprehensive public school, and the teachers are similar in the schools. The local comprehensive school has better facilities than Emily's school in many ways, so they have two dance studios, they have extraordinary opportunities in performing arts, and they do well academically. It's a very, very good school. I also have spent 20 years teaching law at UNSW, so I see the kids who come out of the selective school system, and I think there are real problems with the system.
What are they? What do you think the problems are?
I think the problems are...
Why don't you just go for one another? We'll argue about this.
The problems I see is that it results the selective school system, but very much the coaching system that feeds into it, gives a very distorted perception of education. So education becomes a game which you win by getting the highest marks that you possibly can. And the way you do that is making sure your strategy is to predict as accurately as possible what is on the exam and to give the examiner
I want to ask Shuming's parents whether they agree with this. Lee and Jason, do you agree with this? Is it just a game to get into this?
I meant a serious game. I don't mean a funny game.
I know you mean a serious game.
One thing I want to say is that when we talk about equal opportunity, are we back in our minds thinking about equal outcome?
You have to differentiate.
I mean, it's not. It has to be based on the kid, whether he or she wants to do it. And I have two boys, one in private school, one in public school. The kids are different. It's the kids that determines what kind of school.
I don't think equality ever meant everybody being the same. You can be equal but different.
Yeah.
I mean, some where I grew up, I mentioned before, we had a technical school, a high school, there was a Catholic school. People chose. We live in a country where we celebrate that choice, and many people come to live here because they can do so much for their children.
Okay, Jane, the
trouble with that is that all over Australia we have the same basic hierarchy of schools in every area, regardless of whether the area is rich or poor. And it goes basically like this. At the top of the academic tree is the public selective school, if there is one. The next one is the highest fee private school. Then the next one after that is usually the girls' school, whether public or private, that gets the highest academic results. Then we go to the co-ed comprehensive. It could be Catholic, it could be public. Then we go down to the boys' school, usually the public boys' school, which is the least high achieving. Now, if that is the hierarchy of results in most areas of Australia, then we're not talking about choices, we're not talking about anything else. We're talking about actual predicting of how kids are going to do, which is nothing to do with, you know, their determination.
So you're saying it's the structure of the system that's the problem?
The system is actually, it's actually advantaging
some determined by themselves. I mean, somehow their own effort doesn't matter.
To an academically selective school are more determined to achieve in their HSC
because they come from high socioeconomic backgrounds disproportionately.
Working class people
disproportionately. We know that. We've got the evidence.
Okay, one at a time. Jason, what did you want to say?
we are looking at this background, the socio-economic background, rather than looking at the process that making them change.
Okay, but Jane's point, Peter Garrett, I want you to answer Jane's point, which is that the structure of the system is part of the problem.
Well, look, this is a really useful, healthy and fascinating discussion. It's one we quite often have when I do the forums, and sometimes with the Prime Minister, about what we're doing in education reform. Now, I'm the product of both systems. So I went to a public school at the primary level, and I went to a non-government school at the secondary level. As a minister, what I'm very interested in is how we can create the best opportunities for kids to do the best that they can in whatever school that they're in. So we're not looking at schools on a systems basis. We're looking at schools on the kids in the school performing the best that they can basis. So we've provided a lot of support for low socioeconomic schools through national partnerships. We provide a lot of support for teacher quality because we know that that's really important. But we do need to look at whether the way in which we fund schooling is about funding the effectiveness of the education outcome and on what basis we should do it. Now, one of those bases should be need. We should address the question of need, and I think that's a very exciting thing that we're just about to look at.
And we're not now.
not specifically, no.
Can I jump in there on that point?
Yep.
I think the interesting thing here, as the Minister was talking about, it's funding based on need. I think public and private labels can sometimes cloud more than they clarify. There are some private schools that get money that perhaps, well, that they don't need. There are other schools, public and sometimes private, that could do with much more based on the needs of the students.
Is that a good formula, Kevin? Need?
Well, as we know, the current model is actually based on need. So,
well, the Minister just said it wasn't.
Well, if I can finish. The socio-economic status model introduced under the Howard government, if you're a school like the King's or Melbourne Grammar, you would be lucky to get 13.7% in government funding as to what a government student would get.
OK, Peter, I just want you to respond to different views here. I mean, you're saying it's not based on need at the moment and it should be. Kevin's saying it is already based on need.
No, look, I don't think that it is, although there is a need component in it. But governments haven't traditionally looked at funding education according to what the education outcomes they're seeking for the kids in their schools. That hasn't really happened specifically. I mean, of course it's been part of the policy framework, but it hasn't been a specific thing that governments have done, and I think they should.
OK, Blake, you wanted to jump in.
What Kevin says about it being based on a needs basis, he's absolute rubbish. We can just look at the comparison of my school. On where I go, in Illawarra Sports High on the South Coast. My school gets less money than Knox Grammar. I go to one of the lowest schools via socioeconomic status in the state, and Knox Grammar gets more money from the federal government. Where's the equality in that?
OK, now you're a...
You're not adding government and state. You're misleading people. If you add government and state funding, if you look at government funding from both, your school actually gets more money.
Yeah, but why should...
The other school, the parents put in... And I don't think we're at a stage where we say to parents, you lose money because you're working hard and you want the best for your children.
Hang on, you can get the best for your children in a government school. Mm. I really hate the way people say, exactly. Oh, you want the best for your children, you'll have to pay and go to a private school.
I didn't say that. I'm in favour of choice.
Yeah, okay. Blake, I just want to pick up on your story, though, because you're a Year 12 student. You're a smart kid in a below-average performing state high school. How have you managed to perform well at that school?
It's through hard work. You have to have extreme personal determination, and even then it's hard. I can confidently say that I believe that I would have done better if I was at a higher school or a private school.
You had a chance to go to a private school?
I did, and I didn't do it because at the time I think I was a little bit naive and thought that I probably could get the best from my public school, but at the moment I just don't think the resources are there. For me, like at the other day, I had to go out and buy a textbook because school can't afford it.
But do you think it is because of the resources or because of the students? Like, if you went to a private school, would you achieve better because you had smart boards or because the students were willing to achieve?
No, I think I would perform better because I wouldn't have to go out and buy the textbook. There would be a variety of textbooks already there because the private school would have the resources.
OK, describe your school a little bit more for me. What's your school like?
Well, it's tough. At the moment, we've had a hole in the first layer of the roof all year. still waiting for it to be fixed?
I think that we are making completely unrealistic demands of schools. So that a lot of the really complex problems we are talking about, no school teacher is ever going to be able to solve. I have kids in the local government school. Emily's school is not better funded than your school. Their school, her school leaks. They have a lake in the middle of it that never drains.
OK. We've still got the gap, though, and we still think the gap's unacceptable at the level that it's at.
Well, we need to fix that gap by actually looking at the amount of money that individual students may need to overcome the difficulties and disadvantages they bring through the gate of the school when they first arrive. We have some kids that are going to cost us $30,000, $40,000 a year to educate, and some kids that are going to cost us $6,000 a year to educate because of the difference of what they bring with them as they come. And we need to be doing something about looking at that. What we do now is we don't do that. We actually talk about equity as if giving all kids the same amount of money would somehow be equitable. It simply isn't.
OK, Gary, I'm interested in your perspective on this, your principle of a small private religious school. Yep. What do you think? You've got, 250 students?
Yep, and when it rains, we run for the buckets because the roof leaks because we bought a Jeff Kennett school 15 years ago and haven't had any money to fix the roof. So we have those physical problems. We also have students who got ATAR scores of 99.4. We have 25% of our kids are in the 90 ATAR score and above. We have huge results, and yet 98% of our kids come from Middle Eastern families, 50% don't speak English when they start at our school. So how do we get good results?
Bishoy is one of your students, but can you answer that question?
Yeah, well, I'm Egyptian. Both of my parents are Egyptian. And I'm with Mr. Underwood on this. I think that if a kid wants to learn and wants to achieve in life, they will. Like, we haven't got electives. We haven't got art, woodwork, metalwork, all that kind of stuff, but we still, 2 years ago, every single one of our students went on to tertiary studies. Every single one.
The National Partnership Scheme is a great development. The amount of money that Peter has put into the National Partnerships to train my staff, you know, from where they were 2 years ago when I started to where they are now, is mammoth improvement in the quality of teaching that we have.
Louise, what do you think listening to this? Because you're the acting principal where Naomi teaches, and I just wonder what happens with the kids at your school when they become high achievers? Do they stay in the government system or do they leave?
Look, our parents are extremely aspirational for their children, and any suggestion that children who come from communities that serve low socioeconomic families aren't ambitious for their kids is absolutely, it is nonsense. But they do skim the cream off, and there is a perception. Our parents certainly have a perception that if I can make a choice about where I send my child, whether that's to the hierarchy that Jane described, you know, pretty much exactly I would say that our parents feel the same way. If they can make a choice, then it's just implied that that comprehensive public school, there must be something wrong with it if I've got other options.
So that private schools are a better option for their kids? Is that the assumption?
I think private schools certainly have that social capital about them. They do. And when you've come from a disadvantaged area yourself, many of our families have not been through school themselves here in Australia. They aspire to that, and there is this social cachet around.
And what does that mean for your school?
Look, I really don't want to get into a public versus private thing.
But I think it's interesting if we're looking at what happens structurally with the system.
Look, it's very difficult to see, 20 year one children walk out the door when you know that they've performed really well, and teachers like Naomi have worked very hard throughout all of kindergarten to raise these students from coming in speaking very little English to exiting our school reading at a level, 9, 10 and above. It's very hard to see them walk out the door, of course it is, but I don't think that it's as simple as the good kids go to the private schools and the other kids stay with us. It's not as simple as that.
From a marketing perspective, which is my background, of course, there is one universal thing. Anything that is difficult to get into, that is, it's like buying a first-class ticket as opposed to an economy ticket, is more aspirational. People want what's hard to get into. They want to go to the selective school. They want to go to the fee-charging school because they see it as something to aspire to. Comprehensive schools labour under a market problem in that they're open to everyone. Yeah. That has, across all markets, it has the tendency to make people think, oh, well, it can't be as good. I happen to think that's wrong. Maybe I've been in marketing long enough to know just how kind of superficial those judgments
are. So why is it if I want to go to Baldwin High, my child, I need at least $1.4 million to buy a house in the enrolment zone?
Public schools operate in their local
area. You see, we're
area.
Differentiating between non-government and government, but in fact, it's not just selective schools.
No system
in Sydney,
is perfect.
Melbourne, Brisbane, Adelaide. If you want to go to some of the best government schools, you
well,
need $1.4 million
like,
dollars
well,
to buy a house.
High will be the okay. same as
so I think we need a program to stop people buying those homes on the grounds of equity and social justice.
Yeah, you'd be right, Kevin.
Peter.
Well, we're certainly not going to buy into that particular policy suggestion.
Education look, and real estate, not a good combination.
That's right. Look, I think one of the things that really strikes me as the Education Minister is that Australia's got a very diverse education system. Now, I think the fact is that the Australian public accepts that. There are a lot of complexities in the culture and the exchange and how kids do in the schools and so on. But the challenge for us is to recognise that we've got that diverse system and to make sure that the way in which we fund schools delivers to the kids, whatever school system they're in and whatever school they're in, the best opportunity to succeed to their potential. Now, you're focusing quite rightly on the equity gap, because that's one of the things that the Gonski panel showed us. But it also, as Kevin said, showed us that our best performing kids are performing as well too.
What about the idea of being able to choose the kids who go to a school? Jane, what do you think? I mean, private schools can theoretically choose the kids.
Well, with that hierarchy that I described before of the aspirations of parents for various different types of schools, basically what that means is that the more desirable schools, both public and private, can pick and choose which kids they will accept and which kids they won't.
Are you saying they shouldn't be able to do
well,
that?
Well, I don't know whether they should or they shouldn't, but they can. And but let's be realistic about the effect that that has. Basically, that means when we talk about choice for parents, what we're really talking about most of the time is actually choice for some schools, because there are certainly many parents who have little or no choice. If you don't have enough money to pay fees, if you've got a boy who's good with his hands, you will find not much choice in terms of where you'll send your kids. And the same with parents of kids with disabilities who don't have the money to pay fees.
OK, Blake, what do you think about the whole idea of choosing, hiving off kids into
a... I think part of it is morally wrong, that a private school should be able to maybe reject a kid. I know that we've had reports of some schools rejecting kids because they're gay. We, of course, have schools who reject because they're not so smart. I mean, they're kids. At the end of the day, they should be able to gain the best education possible.
OK, up the back, you wanted to say something.
When we talk about this, we shouldn't just say it's public or private. We're a private school that caters for kids that don't fit in the mainstream. Most of our kids are low socioeconomic background. Jacob's from our school. And they wouldn't last in a mainstream school. They need a one-on-one teacher. They need a class of four. They need a small environment. They need flexible hours and flexible welfare issues to help them. So I don't think we can just say that all private schools are like this and all public schools are like this. We should clarify and just say disadvantaged.
I think there's a bit of a sort of... One thing that sort of bugs me a bit about the debate is it seems all about more money and our kids getting the top of the top, the selection. And I think some more pressing issues is actually getting young people to school. Literally, you know, like in Tiwi Islands or Top End, driving around and picking up kids and getting them to school, wanting to attract them and wanting dudes like yourself to come to school because you dig it, because it's interesting, because they can engage with it.
Jacob, you were agreeing when Morganics was talking then about how to get kids more motivated.
When I was attending Sydney High, I travelled from the Central Coast to the city. It took 2.5 hours to get to school.
Now, tell me a little bit more about that, because you talked earlier about dropping out of school last year when you had a reading age of 8, I think, when you dropped out at the beginning of last year.
Yeah.
And then you went to East Sydney High, which is a independent school. Yep. What was it like? How was it different?
It was more one-on-one. They would help you, like they would sit you down, like with my English, they would actually sit me down and like make me say words over and over again until I get them right. Like they would help me with it. Just everything. If I had any problems like travelling, they would help me with bus fares, just everything all together. They would always help me, no matter what it is, they would try and help me in some way.
And did you have to pay fees to go to that school?
No, you don't have to.
No, shaking your head up there.
Yeah.
Sorry, $50 a term. If they can afford it. So how can you afford it as a school?
So we get grants through, we're a charity organisation as well, so we get grants from people donate money. We get government funding as well, the same as any other private school.
How many kids at the school?
At the moment there's about 27 kids so far this year, and last year when Jacob went through, 52. So very small numbers, you know, very limited classes, and the main thing is trying to deal with the welfare issues as well. So with Jacob, he had a lot of stuff going on, and education was secondary to everything else that was occurring
to him. Do you want to talk a little bit about that, about what else was going on?
Yeah, I recently got kicked out of my mother's place, and I was actually living on another kid who went to that school on his couch for a few months. Then, like I said, I moved to the Central Coast with me and my sister, and yeah, I just travel to school every day.
Every day you travel from the Central Coast
2.5 hours school.
The inner city of Sydney, which took how long?
2.5 hours. Half an hour by bus to the train station, and then 2 hours on the train and back.
That's motivation, yeah. And what's your reading and comprehension like now?
Oh, I'd say it's... they said it was up to about 90%. I got 90 on my English test. 70? 70,
correction.
In his school certificate test, you got 70.
I got 70.
So you got your school certificate?
Yep. But my old school before that, I probably would have got maybe 40, 30. Well, it wasn't that high.
Why is it, though, that it takes a school of 27 kids that's a charity to be able to deliver that result rather than our government-funded comprehensive system? Why does it take that to deliver an educational outcome that's better than our government system? Peter, why do you think it is?
Well, I'm not sure it's always going to be better, although I think you're doing a great job. I think the question here is a simple one. There will be a number of kids, and Jacob's one of them, for whatever reason, who will require a certain amount of extra support and effort to be focused on them. And depending on the range of issues or challenges that they have, they may require the opportunity to have specialised help in the system. And in this case, clearly, it was on offer there.
What made this change? It sounds huge.
It was a big change. It was just that everyone was sick of being the low-rep school.
Mr. Napoli, what did you do? Tonight we're talking about our schools and whether kids at them get an even break. Martina, now you talked much earlier about how difficult it was at your government school in Melbourne. Tell us what kept you at that school and what changed.
Well, I stayed up until about year nine, and then I started thinking to myself, I've got to do something about this. I saw some of my friends from other schools getting a better chance at things. And I'm sitting there going, why should I be kept back? So that was it. That's all that we were thinking was, by the end of that year, I was gone, moving to another school. And then Mr. Napoli came to the school. We had a whole new principal. Mind you, we had changed principals about 3 times within 3 years. So when Mr. Napoli came to the school, my mum went to speak to him. And when she did, he goes, I've got plans. Hold off with the move. Something's going to happen. My mum's sitting there going, all right, well, he seems confident about it, so we will. I stayed, and it was one of the best decisions I made.
Why?
Because with the change, everything changed. You had students that left, and we had other new students that came in that were more willing to put everything aside that was happening outside of the school. The reputation we had, they didn't care anymore. And then everyone had more of a positive attitude to come to school. That's like on the topic before of how everyone was saying, oh, yeah, just leave and go to a private school if you've got that higher intelligence or whatever. But everyone that stayed behind, we were helping each other. If someone was
What made this change? It sounds huge.
It was a big change. It was just that everyone was sick of being the low-rep school. So the moment Faulkner College closed down and reopened as John Faulkner College, everything was new. And even walking into the school with a new uniform, blazers, shirts, ties, we felt new. We felt like we belonged to somewhere.
Mohammed, you go to the school as well. What was that change like for you?
The change was a big one, one that I wasn't actually expecting. Similar to Martina's story, coming to the end of year 9, going into year 10, I was convinced I wanted to leave. absolutely 100% sure. Going into year 10, I was advised by several teachers, just like Martina, to stay and that things would change, things would look up. And I did, and here I am today.
Mr. Napoli, what did you do?
Goodness. It's not me. I mean, it certainly was very much involving the community.
Well, this was an experiment in Victoria, wasn't it? And it was how much money, extra money, did you get?
Well, basically, there's been funding for the last 3 years with National Partnership, which would have been along the lines of $200,000 a year. And then there would have been some money from the state, which would have helped in terms of the initiative. The closing of an old school, the reopening of the school on the same site. But that was only the symbolic component of it. It was actually internally what we were doing.
So how many of the staff that you had did you keep?
We changed roughly 45% of the staff.
Wow, yeah. That's a lot of people.
It was a massive change, and it wasn't an easy thing to do.
And could you have done that if you'd been principal without it being this experiment?
The short answer to that is no. Certainly without the support, both state and federal funding to come in to support this initiative here, I think it's almost impossible for any principal, any school community to do on their own.
And were the teachers, the motivated teachers, the key to getting the kids motivated, or were you getting the kids motivated separate to that?
It was a combination of, but clearly having the right type of teachers and professionals that could really embrace what the change agenda is, that can ensure the fundamentals are being delivered in the classroom of really good teaching and learning. That's key.
What are your outcomes like?
Outcomes have certainly improved over the last couple of years. Mind you, this has only taken place from the start of 2010, so it's still a relatively fresh journey.
Peter, would you like to see all schools to be able to do what John Faulkner did?
I'm proud of the fact that we are actually encouraging principal autonomy. We expect about 1,000 pilot schools around Australia to do the kind of things that we're hearing about at John Faulkner. In other words, give the school leaders the opportunity to take charge of their school environment and determine how they want to basically make the school go better.
But we mustn't ignore that you got extra money. You got $200,000 extra money. Now, there are a lot of principals out there who would love to do something similar, but they can't. They don't have the money. And what we find when principals are given autonomy, say with the Kennett Revolution, a lot of the things that they were able to do, well, they were able to do because they got more funding.
He got rid of 45% of the staff.
He had the extra money, and you said, didn't you, that it was incredibly important to have that extra money.
Okay.
People always say, money's not the answer. But only people with lots of money ever say money's not the answer. People with no money are always saying, yes, it'll help a lot, thanks.
Peter Garrett, David Gonski says our schools need $5 billion extra money. Are they going to get extra money? I know you're not committing to the $5 billion, but can you say that they're going to get extra money on top of what they get at the moment?
I'm not saying at this point, Jenny, I'm not ducking the question, but I'm just getting it the right way around. I mean, Mr. Gonski made an estimate of the amount that he thought would be needed. We now need to work that through with state governments who run the government school systems and through the independent school sector, and there's a lot of work to be done. Once that work is concluded, if we can reach consensus as a country on a new schooling resource standard, then we will look closely at what it will cost.
And can you close the gap without more money?
Well, probably not, but it's just not about money only. I'll make one point here to Jane and others. I look at the amount of money that we do spend, for example, on Indigenous education, and I think we can safely say that that money is not doing the job that we want it to. Mm-hmm. Yes, we know that money applied well and where you've got good teaching, a focus on good education in place can make a difference.
Blake, you're in the New South Wales Youth Parliament. You want to be Education Minister. Da-da, watch out. If you had his job...
Careful what you wish for.
If you had his job, what would you do? If you had Peter Garrett's job?
$5 billion. the full Gonski review. For us to ever get anywhere in education reform, we need to look at what Gonski said, we need to take it seriously, and we need to implement it in its full recommendations.
Gus, I want to go back to you just for one minute. How did you attract good teachers to teach at your disadvantaged school? Because that's key. Key to this. How did you do that?
Oh, look, it's taken time, and you know, it's about investing in your teachers as well. So some of the teachers that we had actually attracted to the school was about investing in them as well and developing their capacity, and that I think is key.
Did you pay them more?
No, absolutely not. I mean, as a state government school, we're set on, you know, certain salaries.
Emily, why are you frowning?
Well, I just think that an issue that's sort of being avoided here is what is the purpose of education? I mean, a lot of what we're talking about is we're measuring success of schools by their ATAR score or whatever it is. But, I mean, look at Jacob. I mean, he has succeeded in his education because he achieved his Year 10 school certificate, and that means that he can get an apprenticeship and do what he wants to do. The purpose of education should be education for life rather than education for being a doctor or getting 99.95.
Martino, what did you want to say?
I was just going to add, think of it this way. From going to a school that I thought I had no hope with, I'm actually studying right now to be a teacher. So I want to be able to give, because I absolutely love two subjects, right? I always found art very interesting, and I loved it, and sport. And I always thought, I had great teachers in those two subjects, and I always thought, why shouldn't I give that feeling to someone else? I loved it so much, they can love it too.
Okay, we do have to wrap it up here, I'm afraid, but you can keep talking about this online. Go to our website, Twitter, or Insights Facebook page.
Next week, we catch up with a group of teenagers we first met at 13.
Stereotyping cultures and religion other than
our own. Hang on.
Then the world is not going to improve.
3 years later, we talked with them at 16.
I've gotten drunk a couple of times and I ended up crying one night. That was pretty funny.
You think that it's something that I should not be doing? Well, I'm actually going to do it. And I'm going to prove that I can do it and accomplish things in doing it.
So what are their lives like now at 19?
I was drunk and I know it just one thing led to another and yeah, there was a bit of blood. A fair bit of blood.
There's so much going through my mind, it was all happening so fast. He was actually dead in the dark when we had him.
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned for Dateline and World News.